Hello, I'm Francesca Sarmiento. Welcome to the show about ordinary people affecting the lives of others in extraordinary ways. Join me. Let's get to the heart of the matter. Hello and welcome to Heart of the Matter. We have with us today former Manila Mayor and Secretary of the Department of Environment and Natural Resources, Mayor Lito Atienza. Good morning, Mayor.
Good morning.
Thank you for joining us today.
Well, it's an honor.
And maybe we would like to go straight into the heart of the matter, our topic for today, your life as a politician, and later on we'll go into your family life as well.
Thank you.
How and why did you start in politics?
I grew up in politics, I can say that, because my family has always been involved in political activities, government, public service. My father was a full-time public servant. As far as I can remember, so as a young boy, I already was exposed to politics, specifically the Liberal Party. My family was one of the co-founders of that party, and it was founded in Manila, in Quiapo. My uncle was one of the framers of the Liberal Party together with then President Manuel Rojas. So you can see the historical roots that I have in politics. As a young man, I already thought that someday I would like to be a public servant myself. And rightfully, correctly, 1971 gave me an opportunity to run for public office as a member of the city council belonging to the Liberal Party. And believe me, that was a very traumatic beginning, because our first rally was bombed at Miranda.
This was your first attempt.
Right, and I was there in that stage when two grenades was thrown in our direction. But miraculously, I was one of those
survivors.
Not only survived, totally uninjured. Not even a wound or anything.
There were better plans for you.
I credit that to divine providence protection, because God had different plans for me.
Yeah, he had bigger plans.
The bombing did not deter me from my vocation. Although I lost that election, I was a real novice, novatos. I didn't know how to handle a campaign, how to win a campaign. I lost, and that did not discourage me. I went on in public service. I took a post at City Hall of Manila, and I became one of the officers of the Liberal administration. The mayor who won in that election, Mayor Ramon Bagatsin. So I became one of the officers of his cabinet, and that continued me, gave me the continuity in staying on in politics. 1984 gave me an opportunity to now fight the Marcos machinery in Manila as a member of the UNIDO, the United Opposition in the city. As a Liberal Party belonging to the UNIDO, I ran for the General Assembly. And that time I won. So I became a member of Parliament in 1984.
That was your first entry.
As an elected official. And the rest is history. 2 years after, we were able to oust Marcos and so on. And we were able to have President Cory as the succeeding president. I continued on politics. I served under President Cory as her housing man. In 1988, I ran for mayor again, or rather for the first time. I didn't quite make it. President Cory supported the other guys. And unfortunately, because of that, I lost the election. So I returned to my private life, mm-hmm. private practice as a public relations man. Mm-hmm. But in 1992, again, the call for active participation in politics was given me. I ran for vice mayor. 92, and I won.
Okay.
92 to 98, I was vice mayor. And 98, I was given the opportunity to run for mayor.
Ah.
And having won that, I continued to win in 2001, re-elected in 2004, and became the record holder in Manila's politics. The only three-term mayor, garnering the highest number of votes, with the biggest margin posted against my opponent.
So during your earlier years, that 800 small margin was nothing compared to this.
Ah, yes. I told you, the beginning was, did not deter me, it only made me more decided to learn more about our political system and generate more allies and friends.
Mm-hmm.
Sabi ko naman noon, hindi naman ako natalo eh. Kulang lang ang boto ko.
So from your early years, from the rough start that you experienced in your early years, what do you think changed eventually?
I believe that everything happens in God's plan. And I did not stop at serving, helping people, thinking of ways and means of improving our quality of service together with my wife.
Mm-hmm.
And my father too was very active then. He did nothing but continues helping others. And so given the opportunity in 1984 to run for the parliament against the Marcos political machinery in Manila, can you imagine fighting the KBL?
Yeah.
But we had a good cause,
mm-hmm.
restoration of democracy, and of course justice for Ninoy,
mm-hmm.
is justice for all.
Mm-hmm.
Those were the battle cries that we were using. And the rest is history. We got elected in Manila, together with former Senator Eva Calao,
mm-hmm.
belonging to the Liberal Party. We defeated the KBL.
Oh, okay. The whole machinery.
Oh, yes. We had no machinery. We had people power behind us.
So basically, your continuous involvement in public service, even if you weren't elected, gave you the training that you needed and the exposure, I guess.
I believe so. That our continuing devotion to and advocacy of service and helping others gave us the opening. Eventually, gave me the opening to be an elected politician, and of course I cherish that opportunity and make good use of the opportunity also, and gave us more opportunities to get to higher positions.
Mm-hmm. And I guess the people saw that, the sincerity of your desire to serve.
I believe
so. And it was inevitable since your whole family was in public service also.
I told you, my wife was very supportive.
Yes.
That made a big difference.
Mm-hmm. Okay. As a politician, as an elected politician, what do you consider your biggest challenge?
Of course, is how to maximize every opportunity that is given you to be of genuine, real service to our people, our city, and our country.
Mm-hmm.
Every challenge that came my way, I weighed it in that scale.
Mm-hmm.
How do I best serve our people?
Mm-hmm.
Every position that I held and every question that is posed before me, I always considered what is best, what is right, and what would God want me to do.
Mm-hmm.
I always referred to what providence, what the giver of these opportunities would want me to decide.
Mm-hmm.
So that gave me that good, solid ground also for maintaining my pro-life philosophy, even in politics.
Mm-hmm.
You see, when I first ran for office, I was advised at the outset, don't follow a pro-life direction. No pro-lifer wins elections in the Philippines.
There was a deliberate advice.
Yes, that was the wrong notion.
Okay.
That was being hoisted on all of us then and even now.
Uh-huh.
Sabi nila, pag naging pro-lifer ka, hindi ka na mananalo sa politika. But
so
I did
back in 84?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
I did not get deterred from that kind of my determination with that kind of distorted admonition.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I continued my pro-life advocacy and continued to win elections and, in fact, creating history in Manila's politics as a pro-lifer. So mali yung sinasabi nila ngayon, huwag sana maniwala ang mga politiko na pagka ikaw ay pro-lifer, hindi kayo boboto ng tao. Pagka ikaw ay pro-lifer, mananalo ka. People will eventually realize, hey, this guy is talking sense.
Yeah.
I'll vote for him.
Mm-hmm. And you were doing this as Manila Mayor. When you were Secretary of DENR, how did you continue this advocacy of yours?
The experience I had at the Department of Environment gave me a broader knowledge, grasp of my pro-life advocacy, that we Filipinos should not really embrace birth control as a means to prosper and to improve the national economy.
Mm-hmm.
That is farthest, farthest from the truth. We don't need to control the number of people to gain in our economy.
Mm-hmm.
We need to manage, all we need to do is manage our natural resources properly, and no matter how many Filipinos are born, eventually we have enough to feed and to really give everybody a good economic condition, basta tama lang ang pamamahala, tama ang liderato, tama ang direksyon, tama ang programa. Yun ang hinahanap natin, ako personally. Every president that we elect, I long for that day when we have a president who will not bother about birth control, but rather concentrate on the development of our potentials. We have minerals in the country, unlike many countries. We have a marine life that could feed the whole world if we manage it properly. We have all kinds of natural resources in the country. Fresh water, for instance. Fresh water, which is now an acute need of many countries. In the Philippines, we have an abundance of this. Every year, we have an estimated 144 cubic meters of fresh water resource. Every year. We use only about 28 billion of this. The rest is wasted. We don't even bother about utilizing fresh water as just one resource. Considering that it's even more expensive now than oil coming from the Middle East. One small bottle of water in the United States, in Singapore, in Hong Kong, will cost about $2.
Yes, yes.
If you look at it from that point, developing lang natin yung ating fresh water resource, and I think we will have a good source of national economy, you know? Yung ating potential as a tourist center. We have so many beautiful islands that could be developed. The whole appeal all over the world now of tourism is the tropical environment.
Yes, that's true.
Diba? Mm-hmm. Clear water, blue waters, white sand beach, good sunshine. We have all of this. Hindi natin dinidevelop eh. We don't seem to see what God has already given us. Agriculture. Agriculture could be one of our main sources of the economy. But we failed. We continue to fail, and I don't see it still coming. So just on tourism and agriculture and aquaculture, I think we're off to a good future.
So it's basically just
don't
education.
Touch the babies.
Yeah.
Touch the resources.
Yeah. Education and awareness of what we already have, and management.
Of course.
Rather than
of course.
Population control.
Palagi ko sinasabi, let's improve the education level that we're in. Kulelat na Pilipinas ngayon sa education. Why? Because we're not giving it enough support and enough management. Ang solusyon natin, sabi nila, bawasan yung estudyante dahil yung edukasyon natin bumababa yung quality. Bakit hindi natin improve quality at yung mga bata huwag natin pakialaman?
Yes.
We're wasting so much time on the RH bill, birth control, and all the other destructive anti-life measures rather than positive development-oriented measures that we could all help as a nation and which will benefit us in the long run and in the future.
Instead of wasting time debating about it, just go for the more positive policies,
exactly,
right?
Exactly.
Be more proactive.
But I'm sure the pro-RH people will continue their efforts, if not this year, next year, and not the next year. But we who believe also in the pro-life philosophy and principle, we must always resist it. To me, the thing that will destroy the Filipinos' future, one single element, is approving the RH bill. Mm-hmm. It will open up the country to divorce, abortion, birth, same-sex marriage, and eventually euthanasia. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, if we maintain ourselves as Filipinos, isipin natin yung sinabi ni Andres Bonifacio, we just celebrated this
Bonifacio Day.
Sabi ni Bonifacio, mag-isip tayo bilang Pilipino, magsalita tayo bilang Pilipino, at tayo gumalaw bilang Pilipino, at tayo magiging pamamarisa ng mundo. Pamarisa ng buong mundo. We can be the model of the world if we maintain ourselves as Filipinos. And let's throw away this birth control program that is forced on us by the Western world.
Uh-huh.
This is not, hindi naman Pilipino yan. Yan ay binigay sa atin ng mga banyaga, pinipilit sa atin. Kasi nagkamali na sila, gusto nila magkamali rin tayo.
So we just have to stick to our values.
Correct. Together with values, our culture. Eh, iba ang galing Pilipino, di ba? Dito nagmamano pa mga bata. Oh.
Yes.
Sa buong mundo, wala nang mano-mano eh. Wala nang paggalang. In fact, sa ibang parte ng mundo, gusto nilang pinapatay na yung matatanda dahil yun daw ay pabigat sa lipunan.
Burden.
Dito sa atin, hindi. Mga matatanda, ginagalang natin, minamahal natin, tinutulungan natin, inaalagaan natin, hanggang sa huling buntong hininga nila.
Yes, that's true. So it's really very obvious your passions for family life and even for the elderly. Whatever service you do, it's really included. And maybe later on, we will get more into that as we talk about your marriage also and your family life. Okay, we will be back with Heart of the Matter. Stay with us. Welcome back to Heart of the Matter. Joining us, Mayor Atienza's wife, Beng. Hello.
Hello.
And good morning. Thank you for joining us.
So,
this segment is not just for Mayor Atienza, but as I was saying a while ago, this is where we will get into the what is behind the passion that Mayor Atienza is showing, has shown throughout his years in public service. And he mentioned a lot of times about his marriage and his family and how he is so passionate about valuing family in life and even the elderly. Let me just refer to, I was told that in 2000, you both went to Rome and attended an international conference for the Pontifical Council of the Family.
Yes.
I understand. Right. How did you get there?
We were designated by Cardinal Sin.
Then the
part
Archbishop.
Of the Philippine, the Cardinal Archbishop
of Manila.
As part of the Philippine delegation the church was sending, that he was sending to Rome. And with pride, we accepted it and we went to the conference.
And what happened? Did you just sit down?
I was not supposed to be a speaker, but given an opportunity on the spot, I was asked to deliver a message to the conference, which is quite sizable.
About 1,000 delegates.
From different countries.
Yes, convention hall.
Okay.
And so I was forced to deliver a message about
our
country,
about
the problems being discussed. And I got the inspiration to talk about our elderly. So before, in the Philippines, we don't have nursing homes as a business because it would not flourish. It cannot make money simply because every Filipino home is a home for the aged. It's a nursing home. We take care of our elderly. We care, you know, grandchildren, children. Mahal namin ng mga lolo-lolo namin. And we take care of them up to their last breath of life. Wow, they never probably heard anything like that, any country like that. Because they were talking about euthanasia already. It's a problem, a real problem. They got so impressed, they gave me a standing ovation. They appreciated the message. And many people after that, after my short talk, came to me and said, where is the Philippines? We want to go there. Yes.
So you actually helped tourism at that point.
Yes, oh, when you promote to the Philippines as an island, an archipelago where people know how to take care of their elders.
May I add also that during that conference for the Pontifical Council for the Family, Lito got another standing ovation to our surprise when he said, Philippines is made up of 70% young people.
That was one appreciated data about our country.
What do you think was the reason why they gave that?
Because many countries now don't have young people anymore. The audience appreciated that particular data about the Philippines so much because today in Europe there are so many old people and very little young ones. Wala nang pinapanganak ng mga sanggol sa kanila.
Mm-hmm.
They are now suffering from what they started 30, 40, 50 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Teaching their younger generations birth control, anti-life attitude. They started that with the RH bill.
Mm-hmm.
And now, ayaw na manganak ng mga nag-aasawa o hindi na nag-aasawa at all. Mm-hmm. Kaya wala na silang younger generation. Can you imagine if you have 4 old people and you have 1 young one
to take care
of all of them? Dito sa atin, we have, even if we have 4 old people, lolo, lola, on both sides, but we have about a dozen young ones taking care of them, we have a natural social security system within the family. So,
kung
tayong kumaya rin sa Western culture, Western world, na nagkamali na eh. Gusto naman nila, magkamali tayo lahat. Mga kababayan natin, dapat isipin nyo na hindi solusyon magbawas ng bilang ng anak. Let God, the owner of life, decide all of this. Katulad ng aming sinunod, sabi namin, kung magkaroon tayo isang dosena, magaling.
Yes. That was the condition before we got married.
Yes, let's talk about that.
Would you like, would you allow us to have a dozen children?
Uh-huh.
I got impressed, so I said, oh yes.
Oh, so it's really very, you're
very compatible. Oh, one of our covenants.
Nobody needed convincing.
Yes. Papayag ba ako siyang dosena? Sabi niya, oh, let's get married.
Did you come from big families as well?
No, I come from a family of 4.
Okay.
Sige naman, 4 din. But you know, this is the moral of the story. So we tried to get as many children as we can. Every year, nanganganak si Ben.
Okay.
Biro ko nga eh. Talagang sabi ko, napakadali pala. Titigan ko lang ang misis ko, nagdadalang tao na. So every year nanganganak si Beng. First year, lumabas si Kim. Kim Atienza today. First born yan. Then another girl, then boy, Ali. Was born and then another girl. Eh yun pala, anim lang ang bibigay sa amin ng Diyos. Gusto namin siya dosena o dalawang dosena. After the 6th, wala na eh. Sabi ng Diyos, sobra ka na.
But you never doubted, I mean, throughout that whole time that you were getting pregnant and then
It's actually advantageous.
Mm-hmm.
Again, we would like to share this with everybody. It is false, wrong to say that pagsunod-sunod ng mga babies, unang-una masama raw sa health ng mother. No! If it's the natural flow of the reproductive system of the mother, then it should be good.
Mm-hmm.
Ang masama yung pigilin mo yan with birth pills.
Yeah.
Oh, second, economically speaking, sunod-sunod yung aming mga anak, nakatipid kami sa damit, sa libro, sa laruan. Puro hand-me-down yan, yung gamit ni Kim, binuro pa ni Ali after 4 children. Tapos yung enrollment sa edukasyon. We enrolled them to the parochial schools here in our district where you have 3 children, libre yung isa.
Oh, okay.
Hindi mas matipid.
And it's, I think, more fun to have siblings.
Ah, yes. Oh.
They're playmates for each other.
Yes. But did you have a hard time, I mean, giving birth to 6 children?
No.
There were no complications at all.
God always provided. So, pati yung health ko.
Yes.
Perfect, yeah.
So, it's not true that childbirth...
All natural, ha?
Yes.
Walang cesarean kaming childbirth. Okay. Puro natural.
So it's not true that childbirth puts the mother at risk.
That's one of the falsities of the RH set of lies.
And you are a testimony.
Yes.
To that.
Yes.
Okay. It's very. How should I say? I think it's wonderful to see that both of you from the start were on the same page in your marriage, and I can really see how Mayor Atienza translated that support that you have in the family in his public service. How were you involved during all those years that he was in public service, and what was your role?
Well, I was always behind him, because I believed from the beginning Lito had a heart for the poor. So I was impressed. In fact, that was one of the reasons why I said yes.
Okay.
I saw in him a generous, a kind heart, especially for the poor.
Mm-hmm.
So how could I not help him?
Uh-huh.
And then also, as a wife, you know how it is to be in politics, quite difficult, but Lito would always say, put spirituality in it so you will enjoy it.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, oh yes, so many people want to help others.
Mm-hmm.
They have no way of doing it, but here people come to us. And he said that a blessing that people come to us.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and I told you she was always supportive.
Mm-hmm.
So all of the other advocacies that we had, I asked her to handle it.
Mm-hmm.
I thought of organizing a women's organization,
mm-hmm.
an organization of mothers and women. She handled that. Kababaihan ng Maynila.
Mm-hmm.
And then we also got involved with organizing the Mahal ko si Lolo.
Take
care of the elderly. She somehow took a direct hand in it.
Mm-hmm.
Then we also founded the Home for the Angels. And that
home
is a home for abandoned babies, a crisis home for abandoned babies. She handled it. In other words, she was very useful all the way in handling the non-government commitments that I developed, because I was busy being vice mayor,
she was complimenting with them.
She was handling all of this. Other responsibilities that we started.
Mm-hmm.
Up to now, we still have the Home for the Angels. Up to now, we maintain the Mahal ko si Lolo, Mahal ko si Lola.
So it didn't stop when you ended your term?
No. We ended, ended my government service, but the advocacies that we started are all continuing now. Especially our pro-life advocacy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And having 6 children, being busy with all of those non-government work, and you being busy with your public service, you still have had time to consider adding to your brood. Is that true? You didn't stop at 6 kids.
We adopted 2.
Exactly.
That's what you mean.
Yeah,
we had 2 adopted
yes.
children at home.
Uh-huh.
And both are special children. One is blind and one is retarded.
Oh, okay. And how did you come to that? I mean, how did that happen? This was after you had your 6 kids?
Yes.
Okay. And how?
And
how
our 6 kids welcomed all of these decisions. First was the Ostara, the retardate, who was practically given to us, a month-old baby, in this house. And we decided to keep her, because otherwise we knew that she had he had no future at all in the streets of Manila.
Mm-hmm.
So we adopted her,
mm-hmm.
and now she is a 20-year-old young lady.
Wow.
Very talented. She has a golden voice.
Wow.
And in her state of mind, she is happy, as we can see, in her own world.
Wow. That's
but of course, showered with affection by every member of our family.
Mm-hmm.
And the second one is a totally blind girl.
They're both girls, yes.
Also, okay. Coming to our home, to our house, to our family, by providence. These are the things we welcome,
mm-hmm.
of course, wholeheartedly.
And how is...
Miraculously, this second girl now is starting to...
What is her name?
Angelica.
Angelica, okay.
She is... We notice that she is already gaining more capabilities, like... After 11 years, she's 12 years old now.
Okay.
After 11 years, she started to talk.
Wow.
We consider that a miracle, because all the past 11 years, she would not utter a word.
Mm-hmm.
Then all of a sudden, she uttered my name, Daddy. She said,
wow.
Did she say anything? I said, what did she say? She said, Daddy.
That must have been a precious
word.
Moment.
And then now she's talking. She's even talking English. And she's starting to, I think, decipher shades of color, basic colors. She knows if I'm wearing red. She knows if she's wearing white, pink, green. We would ask her, what color am I wearing? She'd stare and she'd recognize 90% of the time.
Does she goes to school?
Yes.
Both of them.
Okay.
Maybe it would be good for us to share about one baby that came to us. She was deaf, blind, no palate, tubal feeding, club foot, completely disabled. So both of us, we prayed to God and said, God, maybe take the life of this baby. Because kawawa naman, we pity her. And then it took a while. She was just with us in our crisis home for abandoned babies. And God wouldn't take her away. Only to realize that one day, my sister came crying and she said, you know, I have cancer, so please pray for me. And then there was our oldest helper in the house said, Mom, I'm positive with tuberculosis. And a close friend of ours said, please pray for my baby because she's dying. She's 50-50 in the hospital, premature. And so we went to this baby and we whispered to her, hey baby, could you tell the Lord to help us with these three intentions? And after 1 week, no more cancer, no more tuberculosis, and the premature baby lived. And so we prayed to God and said, Lord, we thought we made a mistake on this one.
Uh-huh.
Only to realize that we have pressure with us. So from then on, Lito and I, whenever we would have prayers, like we need a special good weather for an occasion that he called for, we would pray, hey babies, hey baby, tell the Lord, and don't let it rain from 1 o'clock in the morning. I cannot answer.
Wow.
That's
a real angel.
I started talking Manila of the Atienza weather because of the babies.
Yes, that was the secret. Yes.
Ah, okay. And this is one of the babies in Home for the Angels.
Yes, but we lost her already.
Oh, okay.
Eventually, she was taken by the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
But what Ben is saying is that we strengthen our firm conviction that every life has a purpose.
Yes, yes.
If that baby was given to the home, even in that very, very sad state of physical condition, severe physical defects, it was to save lives, not just for herself, not just to exist.
Mm-hmm.
She was able to communicate to the Almighty whatever we asked of her.
Mm-hmm.
So in that condition, we are confident, we're sure, she was useful.
Mm-hmm.
And in her different many trips to the hospital, I would take her to the hospital every time that she had a crisis.
Mm-hmm.
And in those trips to the hospital, marami rin kami natulungan dahil pagdating sa hospital, may nangangailangan ng respirator, may nangangailangan ng ganito.
She really paved the way for more people to be helped.
You cannot say that a life is useless,
so
therefore it should be disposed of.
Yeah, who are we to judge, right?
Every life we believe is of absolute value.
Mm-hmm.
That life has its own value, and no government, no politician should really meddle with God's plan.
That's so beautiful. Very well said. Maybe a last message for our viewers, given the rich experience that between just the two of you have. I mean, what can you share with our viewers about your experience maybe and your advocacies as a married couple and for your family also?
First?
Yes, please.
I would always put in my mind what Lito kept telling me from the beginning up to this day, that no success can compensate for failure in the home. So whatever state we were in, private citizens or public, in public, I would have that in mind. No success can compensate for failure in the home.
Mm-hmm. So just focus on the home.
Yes.
Don't leave it behind.
And my secret also, when I always tell myself I love my husband 1,000 times more, very often, I love my husband. It works.
Okay, I'll keep that in mind.
I'd like to share to all our listeners that every person, everybody should have a strong faith, believing in God, the only source of life, the source of everything we have, and just rely on His guidance and direction, because every decision you make, if it is God-centered, cannot go wrong. In every junction in the past, political, personal, or anything that came my way, and whenever I sought the divine providence and intervention, everything was given me. Even in my political decisions, whenever I consulted the Bible in my decisions, we realized everything became easy. We have been winning elections guided by that firm conviction. But all decisions that I made on my own, nakalimutan ko mag-consulta. Palpak yung aming decision. Well, these are the
proven
lessons proven to us. I'd like to share to all.
Thank you very much for sharing with us. I'm sure that a lot of people were inspired by seeing this side of Mayor Lito Atienza and by hearing both of you just speak about your personal experience. Thank you once again for joining us.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.
At mabuhay ang ating bansa.
Mabuhay. Thank you very much. This has been Francesca Sarmiento for Heart of the Matter. See you next time. God bless.